Okay, so how is everyone today?
Good, I hope.
Any questions before we get to business? Okay, so fine. We're in a new section now. Section 1.5, which is called factoring polynomials. To introduce the idea, if I gave you 3 times x plus 5 and then said multiply this by 2 times x plus 7, so how could you do this? FOIL, right? So then the f term would be 6x squared. The O term would be 21x. The I term would be 10x. And the L term would be 35. And then, can we simplify this at all?
Yes.
Yeah. We can collect and get 6 multiplied by x squared plus 31 multiplied by x plus 35. And what we're saying is that we have 3 times x plus 5 multiplied by 2 times x plus 7. And these are 2 different ways to write the same thing. Going from left to right, like so, doing that is what we've been doing so far. This is called distribution. And collect like terms. And yes, going from right to left, like so, this is factoring. So, going right to left. That's what we're focusing on now. It's a little bit more difficult than distribution and collect in the same kind of way that walking downhill is easier than walking uphill. So, for example, the instructions are, I want you to factor out as many integer factors as possible. So as many integer factors and variables as possible. Okay, and the expression will be 21 multiplied by x cubed multiplied by y to 5 plus 33 multiplied by x to 7 multiplied by y to 4 plus, I don't know, how about 42 multiplied by x squared multiplied by y to 4. Okay. Here's a nice looking expression. How many terms are in this expression?
Three.
Three terms, right? Because remember that terms are the things that are separated by pluses and minuses. So 1, 2, 3 terms. And considering just the first term for a moment, how many factors does the first term have?
Three.
three factors. Because remember, factors are the things that are separated by multiplies.
Okay, well, in this entire expression, there's three
different sort of categories of factors. There's the coefficients, right? Things that don't have a variable. There's x's and there's y's. So we're going to do this, since this is the first time we're doing this kind of thing, we're going to do it, you know, real slow. So I'm going to focus at first just on the coefficients. So I see a 21 and a 3 and a 42. And what I want to know, what is concerning those three, is there something that we can factor out of all of them? What can be factored out of all of them? Three can be factored out of all of them, right? Because 3 divides 21 and also 33 and also 42. As a result, what we're saying is that we should be able to write the following. We should be able to write 3 multiplied by, and then some parentheses, and then fill in those parentheses. How many terms are going to be inside of those parentheses? Three terms. Why? Because we factored out 3? Right, there were 3 terms to begin with. Okay. So inside of the parentheses, what will be the first term? 7 will be its coefficient, and then what? X cubed y to 5. The x and y business is unchanged because, well, all that we did was factor out a 3. We didn't play with the x's and y's. Okay, as for the next term, what? 11 will be its coefficient, and then what? Same, right, x and y. Okay, and the last term? 14. X squared y to 4. Okay. Now, how can we check that we haven't made a mistake? We could distribute it back, right? Because after all, factoring, the opposite of that is distribution. So if we were to distribute that back, do you observe that this just that term right there would be 21 x cubed y to 5? And similarly, just that term right there would be just that term right there would be 33 x to 7 y to 4, etc. Okay. Now, concerning the coefficients again, 7, 11, 14. Is there anything that can be factored out of those? But wait, I see 7 and 14. Ah, but it has to be all of them, right? 7 can come out of 7 and 14, no dispute. But the issue is that it has to come out of all of them. And 7 is not among the factors of 11. So there is no further integer that can be taken out of 7 and 11 and 14. So we're done with the coefficient. So now let's deal with the x's. So x, there's the x, and there's the x. Okay. Now, remember that x cubed is just a nice compact way to write xxx. That's what it means. And so this means xxx, xxxx, and this one means xx. So the rule for deciding how much can come out, the rule is always that you must choose the least. Among all the terms. So what I mean is that, for example, this term has up to three x's to give, this one has up to 7 x's to give, and this one has up to 2. So of those, which is the least? 2 is the least. Okay. Okay. So what we're saying is that from those three terms, we should be able to factor out x squared. So 3 multiply x squared, multiply, and then what we're saying is that we should be able to fill in these parentheses. Okay. So 3 multiply x squared, multiply. Okay. What will the inside of the parentheses, what will the first term be? Right. The 7 will be unchanged because we're playing with the x's now. And then how much x? A single x, right? Because that means xxx. And we took out xx. Well, so then there's one x left. And then we didn't play with the y's, so this is still y to 5. Plus what now? 11, yes. And then it, x to 5, because there were 7 and we took out 2. And then the y is unchanged. Plus 14, and then how much x? None, right? Because we took them all out. Any question about that step? Okay. Now let's consider. Let's consider these terms. Consider the x's for a moment. So this term has an x. That term has x to 5. And where's the x's for this one? It doesn't have any, right? So can we get out any more x's? But wait, that one has an x. It has to come out of all of them at the same time, right? This one has no x's to give. This is analogous to when I asked, are there any integer factors that can come out of all three? And the answer was no, right? So for example, this one has a 7 to give, and that one has a 7 to give, but that one doesn't have any 7s to give, so we can't go any further. That one has an x to give, that one has 5 of them, in fact, to give, but this term has none, so can't do anything. Everybody's okay to hear? Now we'll deal with the y's. Okay, so then, remember, what's the rule? Choose the least. So what are we going to choose? Y to 4. And it appears twice, so it doesn't matter which one you choose, right? It doesn't. That's not really a thing. You're just, among the choices 5, 4, and 4, you're choosing the least. So 3 multiplied by x squared multiplied by y to 4 multiplied by, we want to fill in these parentheses. So 3 multiply x squared multiply y to 4 multiply by, okay, what's the first term? Very good. 7 times x times y. Next term? 11 what? 11 x to 5. But wait, what happened to the y's? Yeah, we got them all out. Then 14. Any question about this? So under normal circumstances, obviously, you won't write these three lines. I'm just writing them in case you look back at the notes. You remember me saying that, oh, we're going to take out that, which means we need to fill in that slot. But you don't usually write them. Furthermore, you'll usually do more than one variable at a time instead of one. Okay, so let's do one of those. For example, Same instructions as above. Oh, wait. Let me back up just slightly. This, right here, this 3, taking out that 3.
Because 3 could be taken out of all of the terms,
3 is called a common factor. Well, 3x could also have been taken out of all those terms. So 3x is a common factor.
That's a common factor.
This, 3x squared y to 4, is also a common factor.
But this one is special. This last one is special because notice that no more integers can come out. No more x's can come out.
And no more y's can come out.
As a result,
this one has a, besides being called a common factor, it has a special name. What's its name?
Polynomial.
The greatest common factor. And it is a polynomial also. So this one is called the greatest common factor. So, what that means is that now I could say, instead of saying factor out as many integer factors and variables as possible, I can say factor out the greatest common factor. Okay. So now, same instructions as above. And then we'll do this with the additional requirement that express your answer with positive exponents. Okay, so 48 multiplied by how about z squared multiplied by w to negative 3 plus 36 multiplied by z cubed multiplied by w to 4 plus 32 multiplied by z squared multiplied by w.
Terrific. So when I do sequences of examples, my teaching strategy is to introduce one new concept with each example. And the new thing, the new concept in this example, is the fact that one of them has a negative exponent. That's the new thing in this example. Otherwise, the coefficients, blah, 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 that's basically the same as last time. The z's, that's basically the same as the last time, with the exception that it's a new letter, but that's not a big thing. So let's deal with the coefficients and the z's at the same time. And we'll deal with the w's in a moment. So how much coefficient, what is the greatest common factor of among the coefficients? 4. 4 can come out, leaving 16. 4 can come out, leaving 9. 4 can come out, leaving 8. Even if you guess incorrectly, you'll see it when you write it down. So it's not a big deal. Like if we had thought, 2's the best, we would have found out. Besides coefficient, how much z can come out?
Z squared.
And how did you make that determination? Right, so 2, 3, 2.
Well, 2 is the least. So that's what can come out. So z squared, and then multiplied by, and now we want to fill in these parentheses.
Okay, so what goes in the parentheses?
12, because we took out 4. And then how much z?
None, because we took all of them out. And then the w's, we're just going to leave those alone for a second.
Okay, next term? 9. Z. And then w to 4, because we're leaving those alone.
So z, because that middle term is zzz, and we took out zz, so there's a z left.
Okay, plus,
what's the last term?
8, right? And then we took out all the z's, and a w is remaining.
Any question about getting to here? Okay, now let's check. You know, we knew 4 divided all of them, but it might not have happened that 4 was the greatest common divisor among the coefficients. So how can you check that?
Right, so you could check that what we've done is correct by distribution,
and we could check if 4 is the greatest by asking, is there anything that divides 12 and 9 and 8? Anything more than 1 anyway?
Nah.
Okay, so now,
well, now the issue is being pressed. The question is what are we going to do about the W's? Okay. Well, that one, that one, and that one. This represents negative 3. This represents 4. And this represents how many? 1.
And what was the rule for choosing? Choose the smallest,
the least. So among these choices, which one is least?
Negative 3.
So that's the choice.
Okay. So that means that what
am I going to write outside of the parentheses?
4z squared, and then multiplied by w to negative 3, because that's what's coming out.
We'll deal with the over business in a second.
And what we want to do is we want to fill in these parentheses.
Now, one of these terms is easy.
Which one's easy to deal with? The first one, right?
Because we took that out.
Okay, so then this is 12. Okay, it's the next two that is bothersome to students until you understand what's happening. So I'm going to leave myself some blanks and fill those in. So my question is let's ignore this W for a minute, which is bothersome, and I'm going to ask, when we did this, first step that was so effortless, this factor, z cubed, became this factor, z. Why did that happen? We subtracted 2, yeah. Because what we did is that factor began as z cubed. It began as z cubed, and then to get its new exponent, we subtracted the number of z's that we took out. 3 minus 2. Well, that's z to 1, which is, of course, z. So however many things you're taking out, you got to subtract that in the exponent. Okay. Fine. So then how many W's are we taking out?
-3.
We're taking out negative 3 of them. And that means we need to subtract them. Okay. So 4z squared multiplied by w to negative 3 multiplied by 12. I'm gonna deal with each term individually. So then plus, okay. So moving from here to here, and dealing with the middle term, so how many W's do we begin with?
Four.
So it's going to be like W to exponent 4. And then because we're taking away negative 3, we need to subtract negative 3. Subtract negative 3. And what is 4 minus negative 3?
7.
W to exponent 7. So what gets written here in the middle? 9z multiplied by W to 7. Any question about the middle term? Okay, now I'm going to give you a moment to do the rightmost term. Make sure you can do it. So this step we're working on, we're working on the W's. As a result, the 8 is not affected by all that W business. So I'll write the 8. That's definitely going to be there. Now, for this rightmost term, how many W's did we begin with? 1. So it'll be W. And then the new exponent will be obtained by writing 1, because that's how many we began with. And then what do? We subtract how many we took away. And we took away negative 3 of them, so we're subtracting negative 3. And what is that? W to exponent 4. Any question about that? Now, you might be concerned. Okay. Yes? Nope. So, this could be written. You could distribute subtraction into there, and that could be written as W to exponent 1 plus 3. Subtracting negative 8 is the same as adding 8. Subtracting negative 10 is the same as adding 10. So subtracting negative 3 is the same as adding 3. Okay, so let's check the middle term, because I see some concern in the crowd about this. Let's check. How can we check the middle term? I'm just checking the middle term just because I'm just checking one of them. I don't want to check all of them necessarily. Yeah, because this kind of seems like nonsense. How can we check the middle term? We could distribute it, right? But I'll just distribute to the middle term, and I'm going to ignore the others. So that'd be 4z squared w to negative 3 needs to be distributed to that one in the middle. So 9 times z times w to exponent 7.
So we could drop the parentheses, then that would be a string of products there. And then we could commute them into whatever order is convenient for us.
Suppose we commute the integers to the front and then multiply them out. What will we get? 36. Is that good?
Yeah.
Suppose we commute all the z's to the front. We'd have z cubed. Is that good?
Yes.
So now, because this is the point in question, I'm going to commute all the w's to be together, but I'm not going to multiply them out because I want to look at them.
So we have w to exponent negative 3 multiplied by w to exponent 7. So when we have same base being multiplied, what is it that you do? You add the exponents.
So this would be 36 multiply z cubed multiply, well,
what is negative 3 plus 7?
4.
4. Is that right? It is right. Ah, terrific. So we must have done it right. Again, I'm just looking at the middle term.
What was used here is that w to exponent m multiplied by w to exponent n is w to exponent m plus n.
Okay, now that was just, this little check was just an aside. So is the aside okay? Okay, so then now, we were here, and the question is this the answer to the exercise?
It is not.
Well, you might say, is there anything, I can't get out any more integers, or z's, or w's? Ah, right, but it says answer with positive exponents. So the offending item is this. So how can we fix that?
Yeah, by putting it into the denominator. So you could express this as 4 multiply z squared multiply w to negative 3. No, I'm putting that in the denominator. That was the whole point. Multiply the parentheses thingy, so 12 plus 9 times z times w to exponent 7 times, plus 8 times w to exponent 4, and then now all of that over w cubed.
Any question about this exercise? Yes?
Yeah, that'd be fine. Yeah, just that one or just that? Yes, fine, doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because in the end, that's equivalent to asking, sort of, can you put parentheses around that? And the answer is yes, because multiplication is associative.
Good. Okay.
So now, I'll say let little a and little b be in the reals. Then observe that x plus a multiplied by x plus b. We could FOIL this out to obtain x squared plus bx is the O term plus ax is the I term, plus ab is the L term. And then, the terms in the middle, O and I, what's the greatest common factor among the terms in the middle? X, right? So we could write x squared plus, evidently, something, x plus ab. And what's the something? B plus A, right? Because if you factor out X, then you could write B plus A, but I'm going to write A plus B. Because, after all, addition commutes. As a result, therefore, when factoring, something of the form, x squared plus, now I'm going to write big A multiplied by x plus big B. Big A and little a are not related, and big B and little b are not related. When factoring this, we want to find little a and little b such that big A is the sum of little a and little b, and big B is the product of little a and little b. That is to say, for those of you that are picture folks, this is big A, and this is big B. All right. So, one more remark that needs to be made is that note the leading coefficient of x squared of this is what? What's the leading coefficient of that polynomial? It's 1. And that circumstance is so important and so notable. This circumstance is called monic. So we'll be dealing with polynomials all semester. Yes?
Can you remind me one more time to write the leading coefficient of that polynomial?
The leading term is the term that has the greatest degree. So this is the leading term.
And the coefficient is the number in front.
And the coefficient is the number in front. So, for example, here is a polynomial, a binomial. Is it monic? No, because its leading coefficient is what? 3, which in particular is not 1. So, not monic? Yes, monic. So, monic, the circumstance where the polynomial you're dealing with is monic is so nice. It's like that usually indicates like easy mode. Like, okay, this is an easy problem. Okay, fine. So, for example, how about please factor? Please factor x squared plus, say, 10x plus 21. Okay. So I'm well aware that many of you have seen this topic before, but nevertheless, I'm going to do the first example in super slow-mo. Okay. So we're looking for two numbers whose sum is what? 10. And whose product is other what?
21.
And those are taken from there and there. Okay, now it's easiest to start with product. So I'm going to ask, well, how about 1 and 21? The product of those is 21. What's the sum of those? 22. Did we find a winner? No. How will we know when we found a winner? Right. Okay, well, I guess we're all out of options then. 3 and 7. Yeah, that'll work. 3 and 7, the product of those is 21, and the sum of those is 10. Oh, we found a winner. Okay, as a result, that means that the answer is x plus 3 multiplied by x plus 7. Okay, terrific. So now, how could you check your work? You could FOIL it back out. So let's do a quick check. The F term would be x squared. The O term would be 7x. The I term would be 3x. And the L term would be 21. So does it check out?
Yes.
It does. Any question about the opening example? Not complicated. Okay. How about same instructions as before? Please factor w squared minus 14 w, and then what do I want to do here? Come on, brain, make one up. Plus 40, why not? Okay, so again, because I'm pressed on the clock, I'm going to start doing some of these quick. Sum needs to be negative 14, and product needs to be 40. Okay, how about, say, I don't know, 2 and 20? What's the sum of those? That'd be 22. Oh, wait, that doesn't even have the right sign. Look, we need it to be negative 14. And we're getting positive 22, that's not even close. So how about negative 2 and negative 20? Is that product still 40? So we've still got the right product, but the sum's not right. But at least it's negative. Okay, so anybody else have a guess? I'm all out of guesses.
Negative 10.
Oh, okay, negative 10 and negative 4. Okay, good. The product of those is 40, and the sum of those is negative 14. Ah, we found a winner. So what's the factorization then? Okay, good. W minus 10 multiply W minus 4. Any question about this one? Okay, please put away your things. It's time for a quiz. Mm-hmm.